You never mean, have a woman saying, "Are you glad to see me, or is that a purdy in your pocket?"
I should be so lucky.
James Purdy & Sons is a long-established builder of bespoke sporting guns and rifles. Established in 1814 by founder James Purdy, who was my great-great-great-grandfather. His father had been a blacksmith, and he had therefore been encouraged to be a craftsman, and he was lucky in securing an apprenticeship with Joseph Manton. And Joseph Manton, at the turn of the 18th into the 19th century, was regarded as being the best gun maker in London. My principal role, apart from being chairman of the board, is to communicate Purdy to the outside world. When he started, he would have been building probably two principal types of gun: pistols, and there would have been the sporting gun, a long-barreled, muzzle-loading, flintlock-ignited weapon. Members of the aristocracy started to patronise Purdy's during the course of the 19th century, and this really led on to, at the end of the 19th century, virtually all the crowned heads of Europe shooting at Purdy's. On the back of the Industrial Revolution, there was new wealth. Great new wealth, huge new wealth, which enabled people to buy tracts of land in places which previously would have been considered, if not downright hostile, at least inaccessible. And suddenly they had a sporting estate. And one of the exemplars of this was Prince Albert, the husband, the consort of Queen Victoria. Because, I mean, they bought Balmoral up in Scotland. So, there, I've been thinking. So people obviously wanted to model themselves on the royal family of the day. Gun makers of London suddenly had the most wonderful market opportunity. And the sporting gun makers of the day suddenly saw their customers saying, "Can you build something better for me?"
I was actually shocked to see a price list where something like that's about £50,000.
Yes. What we're looking at is the product of something like 800 skilled man-hours. Because this is a magnificent piece of precision engineering. Until very recently, we were taking a forging like that. Now we're actually taking a double forging and cutting it out with a machine to something roughly like that.
Yes.
But we start with that, and out of that is created that. There are many different trades in gun making. Mm-hmm. We start with barrel making, from forged drilled tubes, hand striking those to get the shape. So you can see that it's heavier and thicker at this end rather than the forearm falling off. Then you have the action filer,
yes,
which is taking this down to this. You have the lock maker, which is the springs and things here, which is the sort of actual moving parts. You have the ejectors in here, and the triggers, and the furniture here.
Yes.
As a separate trade, people who only do that. You've then got the woodwork, the stocking from seasoned walnut, and the forend here. And then actually the finishing of the gun is another trade in itself. This is taking a pile of bits from all these different trades, putting it together as a homogeneous whole and making it work. What we have here is an accumulation of, without exaggeration, hundreds of years of knowledge and skill which is passed down from master to pupil. by 1865, the centerfire cartridge had arrived, where we were breech loading,
yes.
But there was still an external hammer, which we were drawing back like that, and we would then fire the gun, the hammer would go, and a firing pin would hit the center part of the cartridge and ignite it. And the next move over the next 15 years was to move to the hammerless gun with the safety catch and the ejector mechanism. So, for the great thing, remember I said speed was everything. You pull back the hammer, it takes time. You see your quarry, you are manning the gun and you are going to pull the trigger and the hammer goes out and bang. You've then got to open, and you do that twice, let's say, and you then open the gun and you have to extract the shell. Along comes the...
Ah, gotcha. So that's what you knock, the person who's annoying you from behind.
You get him straight in the eye. I mean, if you look at Victorian engineering, and I suppose to some extent we are looking at Victorian engineering here, it was a most magnificent combination of art form and technology. James Purdy II was a great innovator. By 1880, we had arrived at the point where we had the double barrel 12-bore side lock hammerless ejector gun, which, you know, to all intents and purposes, that could have been built in 1880 or now. And this is an exquisite evolution of all that is best in sporting guns. I'm not saying, oh, we'll sort that out and we'll use carbon fiber and plastic and ceramics and God forbid.
Oh, yes.
Far better brains than I can have little innovations. You know, wouldn't it be wonderful if I could wave a magic wand and bring back great-great-grandfather, who obviously I never met. But I wouldn't mind betting that far from rotating in his grave, saying, what's that bloody boy up to? And that sort of approach. You don't want to, you know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, and all the rest of it. He's saying, yes, you know, I was always wanting to do that. I was never quite happy with the geometry of that. Well, yes, I reckon that we could do that differently. I'll bet, because he was an innovator. And you go back 120 years, and what was he working on? He was working on the top lever design. He was working on the self-opening mechanism. He was working on the double bolt to pull the barrels back into the face of the action. All those things. On which, of course, they weren't necessarily straight out of his head, but he had the craftsman who developed them with him. He would have been, I suspect, the driving force, the motivator, the inspiration that enabled these things to happen. And, of course, he wasn't slow to patent them and pick up a very nice royalty stream in the process.